Excellent.
Most excellent.
Most excellent.
We are good to go. maybe... Shit.
I know. I'm fucking hot and sweaty, and I stick to these chairs, especially if I tuck my foot up underneath.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been sitting there a minute.
And I'm the dumbass wearing sweatpants right now.
Yeah, I don't know how you do that.
It's comfortable.
Like, I'm fat, and I'm like, spandex and cotton, and if it looks bad, look away, because I'm comfortable.
All my other clothes are probably dirty, and I'm just too lazy.
So since I started my new job,
mm-hmm.
I have yet to put any clothes in the washer or away, and Spencer started doing laundry. That's how fed up he was. Yeah, I know. I've failed as a wife.
Oh, no.
So, but anyway.
Yeah. So, here we are.
Here we go.
Episode 16.
16.
Yeah. Very nice.
Very nice. 16.
Very nice. And who are we doing?
So, we are doing the demon in woman form. I put four.
It's okay.
Whatever.
It's fine.
The demon in woman form, Madame Lalari.
Yay.
Monster of New Orleans.
Yes. And I can already tell you right now, I'm just going to let you probably spat off some of these names because I don't fucking...
Well...
know how to pronunciate them.
Pronunciate. But growing up in the South and knowing a lot of this, it just comes as second nature. Because if you were just to go down to New Orleans all fucking willy-nilly and look at some of those names, you would have no idea what the hell you were saying.
I've looked at the paper and I'm like, nope, just no.
So, if you're unfamiliar with Madame Lalari, she is the monster of New Orleans, and she's quite infamous for many different reasons. And Mary Delphine McCarty came from Ireland.
Yep, she was born on March 19th, 1787, to her parents. Yeah, you go ahead.
Oh, so Louise Chevalier Balthamy de McCarty,
uh-huh.
I believe.
Yeah.
I could be completely fucking wrong, and there might be somebody in France that is just like getting ear raped with my poor pronunciation.
It's fine.
And her mom, Marie Jeannet Larrabel?
Yeah.
Maybe. Shit, maybe I'm not as smart as I thought I was.
It's fine.
Anyway.
Yeah. So her dad was an Irish man and the mom was a French woman.
Woman.
And she was like the second out of five kids. She had an older brother.
Number two.
And some of like their legend of why they left Ireland to go to France was because they were trying to escape the religious and political tyranny of that time. Because I love all of you people, but the bloody English and their monarchs were trying to convert everybody.
Well, there was
that time.
Well, but there's a lot of staunch religious shit kind of everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter where you go, there's going to be some kind of fucking tyrant mm-hmm. somewhere that's like, blood of Christ!
Exactly. And the only other thing that I could really find when she was young is that she was baptized at five per like the Catholic records, and apparently the type of whatever baptism
was because they thought she was close to death because that wasn't, which is weird because everybody has the strangest ideas of how people should be baptized, whether it's like as an infant
mm-hmm.
or if you're LDS, you're not baptized till you're eight. So what's there?
Yep.
I don't know.
I don't either.
Anyways.
So they moved to New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
And their whole family, the McCarty. Yeah, McCartys. They were well-to-do within society.
So they were a lot of the New Orleans socialites. And mm-hmm. so they held very high places, whether it was in city office like mayors or mm-hmm. lawyers or constables. But their entire family was kind of up on mm-hmm. the totem pole.
Exactly.
And so she would go on, Mary Lalari, mm-hmm. she would go on to marry two times, and she was widowed both times before she married a third.
Yes.
So the first husband was Don Ramon de Lopez.
Yes. And they married June 11th, 1800.
Excuse me. And she was 20 when they married,
yes.
which seems kind of funny to me because women usually married quite a bit younger.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I thought.
She was a little bit.
A little bit older.
Yeah. There was... what happened. There was like, they were going from like Spain to New Orleans.
And kind of back and forth. There's some varying accounts as to why they were traveling back and forth, but...
Yeah. The one that we know is that she was actually his second wife, and he had not been given consent from the King of Spain. So it disrupted his military and social placement in Louisiana.
Because didn't he have he was awarded some kind of high ranking
something. Yeah. So he had to go to the Spanish court. When he went to the Spanish court, he had been exiled to San Sebastian. In 1804, he was pardoned when Spain gave the United States the state of Louisiana. So he was on a ship back for a new position or something. And then there's been differences on what exactly happened
He was recalled more than once, but he died on the way back.
Yeah.
So
some say heart failure. It's hard, especially when a case is this old.
Yeah. Which is, I like these ones because there's a lot of like urban legend to it that you'll never be able to substantiate.
Yes.
Which I love that because
it's fun.
It's current day gossip. So, but he did die en route back to Spain?
No,
back to New Orleans.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And during that time is when she gave birth to their daughter. And their daughter's name, I looked at it, it was a full page long. But she went by,
Brikita. I think it's Brikita.
Borkita.
Borkita. Borkita. That's right. You're right.
Yeah. And that's all.
But you know what? All of her kids had goofy fucking names. And we'll kind of get into that because she basically just took her own name and rearranged it three times and fucking named her kids that.
I know.
It's like really George weird. Mormon. George Mormon. George Foreman. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Mary. So anyway, she had this newborn and she would go back to New Orleans and then she would remarry again.
4 years after her husband died. Mm-hmm.
To Jean Blanc. Right. To Jean Blanc. And he was like talk about the prominent positions that he held because he was a banker. All right, listen. Let me get my shit together. He was a banker, a lawyer, a legislator, and a merchant. So he had his fingers in all kinds of pots.
He was also high in the slave trade.
Yes, he was.
Found like 350 documents of his name when it came to buying and
selling and trading or whatever. Mm-hmm. The only one good thing I will say, and there's nothing good about slavery because you should never be captivated by captivity, but they at least had laws in place that were in regards to the treatment and the condition of people that were employed / held as slaves, that they had to be healthy. They had to have clean and considerable living conditions.
Mm-hmm. And he, from all accounts, as nice as a slave owner could be, from what I had found, is like he was actually a pretty nice guy.
Like a decent human being.
And I guess
he actually I believe I read that he actually paid them well for being slaves because a lot of slaves didn't get paid fuck all of anything, but he actually took really good care of them, gave them really nice quarters, and actually paid them.
Mm-hmm. And when we'll get into it here in a little bit, but it's actually known that during Madame Lalaurie's time, there was a couple of slaves that were set free.
Yes, she did.
And one of them was because her husband here put it in his will.
Oh, really?
For the one.
Because there was Jean-Louis in 1819 and then Da Vinci.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's Da Vinci or Da Vinci, but he was also let go in 1832. So a couple of their slaves were actually granted their freedom.
Yes. And the one in 1832, they said that it was probably just part of the local social conventions stating that older slaves with good records should be freed at a certain point. So they don't know if she really
let them go out of the kindness of her own heart or if it was
social status pressure that she had to.
Like some kind of predetermined situation.
Yes. But anyways, with her second husband, they ended up purchasing that home.
409 Royale Street. And it was actually known as Villa Blanc.
Villa Blanc.
Yeah. And the madam would actually go on to have 4 more kids. She would have 3 girls and a son. And then her hubby would actually die in 1816, 8 years later.
So she has 5 kids, little kids now.
Mm-hmm.
Because none of them are very, very old.
No, I would say she probably had 5 kids under the age of 10.
Ugh.
Right?
Whew.
He has a lot to do.
That is.
I'm sure she had a nanny.
Well, then she, almost 10 years later, is when she actually marries the younger man, who's a doctor, by today's standards, more like a chiropractor. And his name was...
Leonard Louis Nicholas Lalari.
Yes. How they came together is because she actually hired him to help one of her daughters who had spinal deformities, mm-hmm. and she was always sick. So he brought a bunch of equipment that I'm sure at this time, 1825,
was very like torture-y,
nightmare fuel-ish. Yeah. Of course, her daughter was never healed, which I'm assuming maybe she probably had
spinal bifida or scoliosis or something which can be helped but at that time they were probably just putting her in really uncomfortable shit to try and straighten her out and probably cause more damage than they did good.
Yeah, probably hurt her more than it helped her, for sure. But this is where Madame Lalari falls in love with him.
And he was quite a bit younger.
Yes, yes.
So their little tryst, which turned to marriage, was not common.
No.
It wasn't uncommon for older men to take a younger bride, but for an older woman to take a younger groom.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you saucy little minx.
Yes. And apparently there was a time by 1826 or maybe late 1825 after they married. Mm-hmm. Well, they married because the doctor said that they were in love, because he was leaving New Orleans to go back to France, and his brother got a hold of him and was like, you can't leave. You knocked up your homegirl. So now you have to do the right thing, marry her. So now she's pregnant with baby number 6.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. And baby number 6 was a little girl that was born in 1826. So just a short time after they got together.
Damn.
Yeah.
Yeah, you fuck around and play with fire.
Yeah.
So then in 1831, so several years after their youngest is actually born, Madame Lalari would go to purchase a property at 1140 Royale Street for about $33,000. And she did this without the help of her current husband. So from being widowed the two previous times, she had come into quite a bit of money.
Oh, yeah. She was suing lots of different people for her second husband's like estate and shit like that when she was selling it off, because people were trying to like gouge her.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I think that like when you look back on what the actual price, like $33,000 then to what it is now, is like $2.4 million.
Oh, I'm sure.
And she had this place built from the ground up for herself. And you can still see it. It still exists. It's still in New Orleans. It still stands.
Yes, yes.
It's quite magnificent. I've seen it really multiple times.
Really pretty.
So this estate that she actually had built without the help of her new husband was something to behold, because this thing was actually like a sprawling estate took up like a big chunk of the block.
It's huge.
And it actually had like really lavish furniture. It had
like marble and mahogany.
Oh, yeah. It was quite lovely. And it still is. Like, you can go there and see it today.
Mm-hmm.
Then it was a two-story building. I think they actually, when they remodeled it years later, now it's a three-story building. This thing's a fucking monstrosity, especially for being in the heart of New Orleans.
Yeah.
Like in the French Quarter.
Well, and for the time in 1831, it was like the biggest building
in the quarter. Oh, yeah. It was pretty...
It was a big deal.
It was kind of a big deal. That bitch has all the nice things.
Stupid.
But she did. She had a lot of really... And that was kind of that New Orleans socialite thing. He who dies with the most toys fucking wins. But then it was like pretty things, which fuck all that, dude. I have a hard time not like breaking dishes. That's why we drink out of red Solo cup.
I'm totally fine with that.
Because I'm a fucking redneck.
Yes. But during this time, she had the two youngest kids still lived with her. So,
correct.
The one from Lalari and then the one from the previous marriage.
Right.
Those poor kids living in that house.
And there's a lot of different accounts back and forth. Like we said, when you go back to a case that's
this old. And it has a lot of
urban legend. Yeah, like some different funk, which is fun for me though, because I like that.
Well, and I don't think
God, I want to take you to New Orleans so bad. We would have such a good time, but our husbands would have to put us on leashes.
Yes, we need one of those retractable...
Fucking no, you don't! Because I'd be like, oh my God! Swamp things! Yeah, dude, and it just goes... I go way fucking south when I'm in New Orleans. He's bad.
You let all your shit...
Oh my God, I go full... Oh yeah, dude. Freak flag flies.
Flies!
It's a day. Well, you know what? You have children. I spent the day on the river. We're both a little tired. It's fine.
Yeah.
And Make words.
And I had my sweet little cousin move in.
Oh, I like him already.
He's nice. He's a good boy.
I'll put him, he can sit under our wing.
All right. We'll he can hang out with us.
You know, we'll fix him.
Yeah, so if anybody's, you know, he's 20.
He's quite handsome.
He's a handsome blonde boy, like Dean Corll would have snatched him up if he was a little bit younger.
Oh, you savage. Because he probably fucking would have. He's a rather lovely kid, and he's single. So yeah. If there's anybody who likes heavy metal, mm-hmm. who's also single, who doesn't have control issues,
yeah, who's not,
you can email us
freak.
At colormedeadpodcast@gmail.com.
Please send in your application, and
we'll play matchmaker. Matchmaker, matchmaker, make me a match. Catch me a dream, catch me a catch.
We need your resume, and we're going to do a background check.
I am.
Because I'm revoking his privileges.
Well, some people's women choosers are broken. Mm-hmm. We should probably do that for a couple of our friends.
Yes, we should.
Anyway, back to
anyways,
it.
Okay.
So, but then it would, like, different accounts of how she acted in public versus how she acted at home would be discussed. And it was, like, widely known mm-hmm. that she had, like, that Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde kind of personality, where she was very polite and courteous, even to slaves in public. Mm-hmm. However,
behind closed doors when nobody's looking,
she was cruel to her children as well as her slaves.
Mm-hmm. Like, she would beat her daughters if she caught them trying to feed any of the slaves.
Or even, like, if they were trying to take them out of the home without her permission, she would savagely beat one of her daughters, which I think her name was also Mary, and, like, put the fucking, like, beat the brakes off this little girl. Ugh. For trying to take a slave into town to accompany her without permission.
Which is just, it's sad. And also, by any account, if you look her up, everybody talks about how she was very beautiful. She's mm-hmm. a very beautiful yes. woman. She was high stature.
Yeah, they would talk about her being one of the prettiest of the, finger quotes, white Creoles. Mm. And how she had porcelain skin and her appearance was unmarked every mm-hmm. time she went into town.
And I saw her paintings and I'm like, you're not that pretty, bitch.
She's got a weird shaped face.
Yeah, but
I guess, I don't know.
It's the time. Maybe she's pretty for
yeah,
her
I was going to say, people have come a long way.
We've evolved.
We have evolved into much prettier people. And the Creoles now are much more beautiful.
Yeah.
So anyway, like I said, there were mixed accounts on how she treated her slaves and how they were acquired, because a lot of people would say that her slaves were haggard and, like, dirty and worn down in appearance, and that they seemed to be in kind of like a wretched condition. Mm-hmm. And when people say things like wretched, that's not a good thing.
No. And there's accounts later that they say that a lot of these accounts of how these slaves were being treated or whatever came from a neighbor. And the neighbor had this weird kind of infatuation with her. And because she didn't repay it, he was bitter. But there's other accounts that shows that she was not a good person.
Right. Because there was actually in one of the books that was written about her, which I think it's in The Ghost of New Orleans is the mm-hmm. name of the book, but it was kind of like the neighborhood gossip mm-hmm. and I can't remember the woman's name. I'm sorry, I didn't write it down and I should have.
Bad, it's totally
bad
fine.
Research. But she had just that nosy hen pecking way about her, and she would always send, like, the police over there or the constable or whomever to do, like, welfare checks on the slaves.
Right.
And maybe it was because it was necessary, which clearly it fucking was, but I think it was also because she was like, that bitch. She's got some weird shit going on in there and I want to know.
Which, you know, by all accounts, she's not wrong, because we'll get into all the conditions of her slaves.
Oh, yeah.
Some of the things that happened.
Now, keep in mind, guys, like we said, this case is aged and not like 20, 30 years old, like hundreds of years old. And so some of this stuff cannot be substantiated, but it doesn't make it any less interesting.
Right. Well, and given the time, and you're also, keep in mind, you're in the South. Uh-huh. Slaves were not always treated so well.
Always? Like, fucking never?
Yeah.
Let's go with almost never.
Or almost never. Maybe like one or two were treated
if you
decent.
If you got to live in the fucking house, you know what I'm saying?
They treated people like dogs, and it makes,
I know, and it makes me,
like,
fucking sad.
Dogs that nobody likes. They didn't even treat them like.
I have such a hard time because there's still a lot of people, regardless of the South, it could be North, South, East, fucking West, that are still mm-hmm. like, we should still have slaves. Ugh. And I'm like, yeah, well, you should be able to say your fucking alphabet.
Right? You should quit fucking your cousin. Like, that's what I think.
You should access some fucking healthcare for your goddamn meth teeth. Mm-hmm. And stop worrying about whether or not you deserve slaves to clean your fucking single wide from 1972 with your shag carpet, you fucking hillbilly. And by the way, there's
your family tree is a post. Shut the fuck up.
Get out of here. By the way, I will always refer to myself as a redneck. There's rednecks and there's fucking hillbillies. Know the goddamn difference. I'm a redneck. Piece of shits are hillbillies. They live.
Think hills have eyes.
There you go.
Versus boxed wine.
Baby. Juicy. Oh. That's a fucking hillbilly.
Don't go with that one. But some of the rumors that kind of go around with the torture and different things that had happened to these slaves that they had held was some accounts say that it was mostly the husband who did some of the weird shit that we'll go into.
Right.
Other accounts say that she
was either encouraged it or participated, because I know that when we get into the fucking main course of this, she did some things which might not be considered gruesome, but are still fucking cruel. Very cruel. Because they actually dispatched a welfare check to the fucking house. They found 9 slaves where they were like, okay, clearly they're not in good condition. We're taking them.
Yes.
Which, good for fucking them.
Right. Which you would think would also have to take quite a bit, because they think that she was influenced by knowing that her uncle had been killed by slaves in 1771. So a few years before she was even born. And then in 1791 to 1804, there was that slave revolt that was in Haiti. It led slaves fought back in Haiti, and there were always reports going on in the news of white people being beheaded, white people being raped, everything like that. So that put a lot of people on edge, because the
right.
white people
well,
were
obviously.
Scared.
Which, and it still happens today, like even in South America, which it kind of is what it is. I think that shit happens in a lot of different places with a lot of different races.
It does.
And you then go, people immediately are on edge and like, that's a fuck those guys.
You go to parts of Africa, and if you're white, it's dangerous.
Yeah, but if you go into parts of the fucking South and you're black,
it's danger zone.
It's a goddamn war zone. And it sucks, because I wish people could just be fucking human beings and leave each other alone.
Right?
Stop it.
How much
bitch,
fucking...
we both eat crackers. We both make poop. We both smell bad when we fucking sweat. Leave each other alone. Either be friends or shut the fuck up.
Right? The color of your skin means fucking nothing.
Nothing to me. You could be fucking heliotrope and 600 pounds and purple, and I'll still be your fucking friend.
Exactly. I'm not going to want to fucking torture you.
No.
So between the 1791 and 1804, with that slave revolt, what happened is in New Orleans in 1811, they had their own slave uprising. So in the same area where they're living and everything like that. And so what the people in the South did was fucking terrible. They, in a way to kind of gain control back over the slaves, they ended up taking well over 100 slaves, and they beheaded them.
Holy
and then they would
shit.
Stick their heads on poles and line them up across the road for like 40 miles. So if you were driving down the road from like the country into New Orleans, all you saw was fucking
heads on spikes.
And then they would
of
also
slaves.
Yes. And then they would also like dangle their bodies over the city gates and shit.
What the fuck?
And it was a way,
what the French fuck?
What in the French fuck is happening?
What, how do we say fuck in French? I need to fuck.
Yeah.
Isn't
Fouquet. No.
Wait, I think fuck is seal. But that's fucked up.
So these times were very fucking
savage,
terrible, dark times, because they were doing that, and you pretty much had to be a slave almost to death in order to gain control, because if they were fearful of you, less likely that they're going to revolt against you, because all of the slave owners had a thing in their head that they would actually lock up their slaves at night as well, which we get into, because that's exactly what she did. But a lot of people during that time locked up their slaves because they were afraid that with the uprising that was trying
they
to
would
happen,
get hurt.
That they were going to go into a shed, grab a hatchet or something, and hack up their slave owners in their sleep. And so slave owners became, you take the torture that they did do, and then you kick it up a notch.
Yeah, but wouldn't you? If you were being held against your will and fucking traded like cattle?
Oh, yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Because I most certainly fucking would.
Oh, yeah. That's why I'm glad that I know, like, in my heritage, we did a lot of underground railroad fucking
scoot
hell
boot scooting.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just never understand it. Like, if somebody wants to willingly work for you in your home and cook and clean and things of that nature and be a nanny, great.
You treat them like gold, though, because
they're
doing shit
that
you don't want to do.
Yeah, they're doing the fucking dirty work that you're like, ugh.
Yeah.
And then you've got this beautiful pillar of a person that comes in and is like, I'll do it. You should wash their feet.
You should.
And give them a foot rub at the end of every day. Not smack them with whips and then lock them in sheds.
This whole case
people
is
are, people
really...
People are fucking bad people.
This whole
people
case,
are bad people.
They're bad people. Oh, this case is hard, and it's going to be hard for all of us now because now... Hundreds of years later,
right.
This is all terrible. Like, we can see how fucking bad this is. But during that time, it wasn't.
No,
it wasn't
everybody was like,
new.
You can fucking slap her around a little bit and lock her in a fucking shed. It's no big deal.
We don't want another slave uprising.
Yeah.
And if you can imagine.
Could you?
Could you imagine? No, because with all of those slaves' heads that they put on poles, everybody saw that. Kids, little kids. Saw beheadings like it was nothing.
It kind of reminds me of that Eddie Izzard stand-up where he's like, fucking heads on spikes. Mm-hmm. Have you ever watched that?
Uh-uh.
Oh, God, I'm going to have to loan you the DVD. But everybody, like even people that were coming into New Orleans, maybe even for the first time, their first impression is fucking savagery.
Mm-hmm.
All the way into town. Ew.
And all just because they had a different skin color. That's it. There's no other reason.
None at all.
And they didn't want to be treated like fucking animals.
They
worse than animals.
Oh, well, you didn't want to be.
How fucking dare you?
Oh my God, you didn't want to be chained to the kitchen stove? Because.
Yeah. One of.
Moving into this.
Yeah.
So Madame LaLaurie would actually. We went like fucking.
We did.
We went off track. That's okay. So Madame LaLaurie would actually lose all 9 of her slaves
mm-hmm.
due to a welfare check where the constable came in, was like, clearly they're not in good condition. They're not holding up your end of the bargain. So we're taking them. Well, but this bitch mm-hmm. managed to reacquire them through coercing her fucking family to buy them while yes. they were on sale, essentially
yes.
at fucking auction. So her family went in because she wasn't allowed to repurchase. So they bought them and then she bought them from them, which what a lovely little loophole of fuckery most foul.
And she specifically wanted all of her other slaves back.
So
because
they she
were thinking,
was,
maybe I can get out of this situation, maybe find a
decent home where somebody's at least going to appreciate me. No. Because she had a fucking plan set where she was going to punish them
mm-hmm.
for leaving her. Bitch, they didn't leave you. They were taken from you because you're a bad fucking piece of shit of a person.
And it took a lot to get slaves taken away from somebody.
Right. So,
that's why when people say later that, because some people now try to exonerate her completely
right.
of anything. And they say that it's all just urban legend and different shit like that. But there are documentations of these mm-hmm. things happening.
Oh, no, you can still see them.
Yeah.
Like, they still exist.
And that doesn't happen in the South.
No.
For any reason. Like, you have to be...
Hello, Django.
Mm-hmm. You have to be pretty bad. And especially later when we get into what the townspeople end up doing. Like,
so, but here's my thing. And this is what really pisses me off. And here's the one time you will only... The one fucking time you'll ever hear me say white privilege.
Mm-hmm.
She avoided being fined.
Yes.
Which was a big thing in the South, in New Orleans. Should they relieve you and take your house slaves mm-hmm. or your slaves whatsoever, you were to be fined a very handsome sum of money, and that money was supposed to be used to get them healthy again, their health care, get them shoes, get them clothes, get them back, I guess, in working condition, which is a fucked up thing to say, but it's true.
They treated them like a broken up pickup truck.
Yeah, we fix it and then we put it back on the mm-hmm. on the go. She avoided being fined.
Of course she did.
Because
she was a
cousin
prissy bitch.
Cousins, uncles, whomever that held these
titles within the community.
And she was like, eh. And then she got them all back. So tell me about Leah.
Because
this one actually really super bothers me. Mm-hmm. A lot.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So sweet little Leah. We know that she was 12 years old.
Yes.
And again, speculation because there's nothing 100%.
Peculation.
Peculations because there's nothing 100%.
No. And this is like basically what happened is the madam didn't do her own like grooming. So whether it was
yes.
like the washing of her hands and feet or other parts.
Brushing her hair.
Brushing her teeth. Getting herself dressed. She had somebody
doing
always.
Everything.
Yeah. Fuck, man. You're not disabled.
No.
You aren't missing limbs. Shit, people that are missing limbs still dress themselves.
She was just a rich white cunt.
She really was.
That's
you
all.
Fucking salty piece of old beef jerky.
Ugh. So, anyways, they don't know if either she fell or pushed or jumped to her death.
I'm leaning towards pushed or jumped.
Mm-hmm. I am too. They're not exactly sure on 100% the year, but they're thinking 18...
Like 32-ish.
32, 33, somewhere in there. And the sweet little girl was just doing her job, brushing her hair.
Brushing Madame Malari's hair.
Yes. And when she brushed, she hit a snag.
And it pulled her hair.
It probably was nothing, because I could imagine...
If you're that big of a tenderhead, grow the fuck up.
And I could imagine that they were probably very gentle with her due to the way that they were treated.
Right.
So I doubt it was anything.
Bitch, unless your grandma brushes your hair with one of those old school bristle brushes and braids your hair so tight that it gives you fucking scalp braids, shut up.
When you were brushing your hair.
Oh my God, you're going to tell people.
The handle snapped.
Okay, listen, you guys. I have very, very thick, very coarse hair. I am Creole. And sometimes when I'm brushing my hair, I will completely snap a fucking handle in half. Well, I used to get in trouble when I was younger for breaking brushes in my hair.
I should not laugh at your PTSD.
It's okay. No, it's like, fine. It's not PTSD. It's just...
No, because you immediately looked at me like you had just shit your pants and you're like, please don't tell anyone.
Please don't tell.
Out of all of the things
I know that I
ship, or even things that we've talked about on this podcast. I know.
So I'm in the middle. We're at this festival and I've been running around like a feral child, like some Lord of the Rings shit. And I go to brush my hair because it's now my kitchen is a mess. It's nappy as fuck. And there's like knots the size of silver dollars back there. And I'm brushing my hair and I go to rake it through and the fucking handle snaps and the brush is just dangling from my hair. And I look at Ember and I'm like, oh my God, please don't tell.
This is the greatest thing ever.
Oh, God.
Okay. Anyways, so her hair's getting brushed, tags it, just tugs at it, just a little snag. Mm-hmm. And immediately, Madame Lalaurie
flies into a fucking rage. Blind rage.
Mm-hmm. So Leah runs.
Well, because this wasn't her first experience with making the madam angry, and she had been flayed once before with a whip.
Well, she's fucking 12.
12.
She's a child.
Right.
You would think.
So she bells.
Mm-hmm. And it would say that she was screaming, and some bystanders and witnesses say that she saw her flee to the roof of the mansion.
Yeah, she was running in fear from the madam who was chasing her.
With a whip.
Like, who's not gonna fucking run? I would run. I'm 36 years old. If I see somebody that's holding something that looks like it's gonna hurt me, I'm gonna fucking run from you.
And they're upset and screaming at you and wanting...
And wanting to fucking hurt you? Yeah, I'm gonna run from you.
Mm-hmm.
So she gets to the top of the fucking mansion.
Yep.
At 1140 Royale Street.
And then...
Does she jump? Does she slip and fall? Does she get pushed?
Some bystanders say that she was pushed. Other people, even some of the slaves, said that she probably jumped
to avoid going to that room.
Yes, because she knew what would happen if she went to that room, so it was...
The room of no return. Let that fucking sink in. When a 12-year-old says, I don't want to go to the room of no return, people went in, they did not come out, so but then what the fuck is happening in there?
When you have sweet little 12-year-old baby girls jumping off of roofs to avoid a whip, come on.
They would rather die than take an ass whipping? That's a pretty severe ass whipping, because she would plummet to her fucking death in the cobblestone streets, and people would say that her blood was flowing like the nearby Mississippi. So I think she head dived right into the fucking street to avoid being hit. So then Leah would then be buried on Royal Street in the corner garden. So was the punishment for common mistake that hardcore?
I'm assuming
it would have to be. Like, clearly I don't know shit about shit, and maybe I should fucking educate myself, because if little kids are throwing themselves off fucking buildings.
Mm-hmm. This whole era was a very dark time in our history.
I would end up dead. Mm-hmm. I'd be that person that stood in front of somebody and was like, you gotta get through me to get through them.
Mm-hmm.
Except they would get through me.
They would.
Because
there were many people that tried that.
There were many, and I am few.
Mm-hmm.
I am Juan.
And
I think that you were viewed lower if you stood up for them.
Oh, yeah. You were worse than even the slaves themselves.
If you stood up for somebody and were like, yo, you're a sickening piece of shit and you're hurting somebody.
God forbid you're being
a human. Yeah, but how do you fucking do that to people?
I don't know. I don't know what kind of justification, because it's that thing that's wrong in my soul. I couldn't do it.
I can't. To actually cut skin with leather, I don't know how people do that.
Mm-mm.
No.
No.
I don't think I could own a people.
I wouldn't want to own a people.
I mean, if somebody wanted to put on a weird little gimp mask and, like, clean my kitchen while chained to my refrigerator, but they got their lollies from it, so be it. But, like, they're all, listen, I just want to wear this mask and scrub your pots. Fuck yeah.
I'll get some more.
I got some fucking two-day-old chili sitting over here. You want to do that shit? But to force somebody to do my bidding? Oh, I guess I kind of do. I'm married to it.
Well, they're in that too.
Yeah, it's a little different.
But you weren't buying children based on their skin.
Dude, I cannot fucking. And did you ever see, like, in the movie Roots, how they put them on display and the one old lady, like, goes up and, like, checks his gens?
Mm-hmm.
You know what that man was made to do, and she was a wrinkly, pickled piece of shit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so sorry, guy.
Ugh.
It's like that movie Kingpin. I think you jarred something loose, Tiger. So this is actually the incident that spurred the removal.
Yes.
So they went in. People had been complaining about the condition of the slaves, but then somebody has clearly fucking thrown themselves off the roof. So the constable goes in. He's like, all right, this is not okay. They take the slaves. She actually buys them back through a fucking relative. Fucking cunt.
Mm-hmm.
Loopholer brings them back. And she bought them with one specific plan.
Yeah, it's because some of those slaves talked about what happened to little Leah. And she's like, oh,
they also talked about what happened to, like, other people that went up in that room and didn't return. And she was on, like,
well, yeah, once one of the slaves had said, Leah had said she didn't want to go to the room of no return. And they're like, well, what's the room of no return?
Anybody that talked. Of course, it spreads like fucking a house on fire.
Mm-hmm.
And then she's like, every single one of you motherfuckers is coming back. And I'm going to learn you a thing or two about shutting the fuck up. And that would be the demise of at least two.
Yeah.
So she had this very malicious plot in which she planned on fucking torturing them and teaching them finger quotes.
Finger
quotes. She wanted to teach them a lesson. And so she got them all back. Once she got them there, one of her daughters would actually try to free them again and get them out of the house. And I want to say it was Mary Delphine. I can't remember the whole fucking name. I should have written it down. Anyway.
Well, they're all basically the same.
They all have different fucking names. Delphine Marie. They all have the same fucking name. Their mom was an asshole.
How could you name off your children when you're trying to yell at
them? But what does George Foreman do? Does he call them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5?
I would.
Number one!
I sometimes call mine oldest, middle, young.
Like, yeah, but have you ever done that thing where you fucked up and you ran through like six names, including your pets, to get to that one fucking kid you're mad at?
I don't know the name. Let's shuffle all of them out and
fuck
one
it's like
sticks.
A 52-card pickup with names. Fucking Paige, Logan, Pudge, Rogue, goddamn moon, cats, god, fuck Salem. You. Yeah, dude, I do it.
I do it all the time.
I do it too. My mom, but by the time she fucking got to you, where she was like, Dave, run, Angela Faye. And I was like,
oh, shit.
Jesus, help me.
Yeah, because then they're mad that they had to run through all the names and then
she
were upset
up
themselves.
So many times. And then by the time she's just fucking furious and she looks like Ursula in the final like stages of the sea witch fucking transformation. She's spitting like black ink out of fucking every orifice. You're like, God, somebody call grandma. I'm going to die.
I'm going to die.
So, sorry. Scroll.
No, no.
Anyway, following that, she got all her slaves back. So she's going to do this fucking, you're going to repent.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but then one of the slaves who had actually been, and this is noted, it was true shit.
Yes.
On April 10th, 1934, broke a fire.
1834.
Mary, sorry. I put 19. I'm a bad person.
It is 1834 because she died in 1849.
Mary. So 1834, a fire broke out in the kitchen of the mansion at 1140 Royale Street, which will be kind of the undoing of Madame LaLaurie. So she had a 74-year-old woman who had actually been physically chained to the stove in the kitchen to do all the cooking, all the cleaning, the serving. And this woman was actually trying to end her suffering by burning herself to fucking death. But she also was trying to set free the souls in the room of no return.
Yes, she was trying to not only free herself in a way, and if it meant her life, she was okay with that. But she wanted to get everybody out.
Else
because
out.
I can only imagine once she got all those slaves back.
What, fever?
Yeah, and a lot of
I had a mouthful of goldfish.
It's fine.
I'm fat and I'm hungry.
A lot of the things that we find later, people say was just folklore, but...
Oh,
If they didn't have problems beheading people and putting their heads on poles, I don't doubt that some of this happened.
I don't either. And I think there's a certain level of what people can make up. And some people are good storytellers and some people are not. And these seem like things you don't make up.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. It could have also been like a case of telephone.
Oh, my God. Oh, I love that game.
I do, too. It's so awesome.
But anyway, so what would happen is this fire breaks out and rescuers would come in and put the flames out before it actually completely engulfed the home. The fucked up thing is, as this fucking house is on fire and there's children and people in it, what is Valerie doing?
She's only trying to save her expensive furniture. And when people are asked, where are all of your slaves? She's like, don't worry about them. Get the fucking throw pillows.
That is a crushed red velvet couch. Get that. Fuck you. Right in your sandy little asshole. You're a bad person.
And they knew that. So they tried to go and find where these slaves were. So they ended
Correct.
Up. So they didn't end up burning.
And what did they find?
Well, they found the room, but it was locked.
Tight. Like you weren't getting in without a key.
And they were asking, like, where the fuck is the key? Where's the key? And she's like, my couch.
Listen,
my lamps.
I got skin people lamps. Which wouldn't fucking surprise me.
No.
So yes.
She ended up refusing giving them a key. So they actually had to break down the door.
Well, so they asked her and then they asked Louis for the key. And he was like, mind your own business.
Yes.
And they were like, okay, but the fire is out. What is in this room? And he was like, nope. And they were like, fuck it. Then a bunch of outraged.
Angry peoples.
Not commoners. God, why would I come up with that word? common folk.
People in the
help
community.
Help me. Yes. Neighbors. Would come over and be like, no, fuck that. What is in that room?
Mm-hmm.
And they would end up kicking it open.
Oh, and what they found immediately. And
it was the following day. So the fire was on the 10th.
Mm-hmm.
They finally came back with enough people to like kick the
override them.
Yeah, kick the lalaries out and be like, fuck you, fuck your furniture, fuck your pretty paintings. What is in that room? They kick the fucking door open.
And when they look in, it's noted that some of them had to turn away and they're throwing up.
Like, yeah, they're throwing up. Like some of them went into shock. A lot of the ladies which would be like us, were like, yeah, we're tough when we get up there. They fucking passed out and had to be carted out by other men. So what was found
in the attic, the place of no return, is when they found 9 of the slaves that she had repurchased, but only 7 were still alive.
Right.
And
2 skeletons had actually been unearthed from poorly dug graves on the property. So these were the 2 that didn't survive their injuries, which I'll mention that when we get into the injuries.
So the remaining 7 visibly had been tortured for a
long time.
Probably from the time she got them back.
Oh, yeah.
That's just it.
You mean that, you know, being chained to a fucking stove and not having access to a toilet or proper hygiene wasn't bad enough? No. Mm-hmm. Let me fucking ruin your day by telling you what she did.
Yeah, when the judge or constable or whatever entered the attic, he found what he found, like, just fucking spiraled him.
Oh, no. He actually, there's like journal entries that you can still find, and I'll have to find the website so that we can post it.
Mm-hmm.
But he actually wrote personal notes in regards to the condition that they found these guys
found.
In. Yeah, because they would be suspended from their necks, not hung, not dead. They were alive, and they were being stretched from dislocated limbs, like their arms, their necks. They had limbs removed. There was one woman, there were several people that were made to wear this iron collar with spikes so you couldn't
move your neck at all.
You were just held in a static position.
Yeah. Well, you could move your neck, but it's gonna hurt.
It's gonna fucking hurt something else.
Mm, yeah. And she had also been found to sit on her knees.
Mm-hmm.
For a long time on the hard, like, tile or
the hardwood floor. But they would also say that Madame Lalaurie would take broom sticks and put them under their knees and make them kneel for long, long times on broom sticks.
Ew.
Ew.
And they found a lot of slaves and their backs were nothing but just like
hamburger
scars.
Yeah, where they had been flayed, where they talked about. So up in this room, she had actually taken a couple of really large cow hides and hung them over the wall.
Not for decoration.
No, because it was to protect
the
wall behind. But what she did was she went and got herself a step stool because she was a petite woman, and she would stand on that thing in order to better beat her slaves and whip them, flay them, slice and dice kind of a thing. But that cowhide was not for anything other than to protect her pristine Victorian walls back behind. And they would go on to say that this thing looked like a fucking blood splattered tie-dye.
And it was thick and
like stiff with fucking blood.
Listen, and no offense to you because you're my favorite people nugget, but if she's not tall enough to properly
bitch, if you can't fuck somebody up with your bare hands and you need to chain them up and smack them with things and you need a stool, fuck you.
Until you somebody, can look at them eye to eye, fuck you face.
No, but if you have to use fucking tools and chain them up, I can't. Yeah, I'm trying to make a fucking joke out of this and I can't.
I know.
I'm trying so hard.
We apologize now. This
it's
episode.
It's a fucking dry episode and we've tried to like fit in some jokes, but you can't really joke about slavery and, you know, like beating people. And I've tried and I cannot.
And it's just, it's all disgusting and sad.
And it just makes me really angry because she was a bitch.
She was a cunt. I would have tripped her.
Sent her right into the fucking mud on Bourbon Street. Here, bitch, have a cow pie sandwich.
She would probably trip and her face would bash across the floor a few times.
Listen, I don't know how she swallowed that pencil through her nose. She was doing this carnival trick and it went wrong. And I had nothing to do with it.
And nothing.
It wasn't me.
It was not me.
It wasn't me.
Mm-mm, not even one.
So, but then when they discovered kind of everything, and this is where it's going to get nasty. And on top of everything else, like we said, and we've tried to make jokes, but then we look at each other and we're like, oh, fuck, it's not really funny.
Well, and it doesn't help that we're also barely awake.
Oh my God. It has been a rough go for, you know, new jobs, mom with three kids.
Yeah.
I just ran the fucking river.
It's been a lot. No sleep.
Yeah.
We had a kid free night, thought I was going to sleep. No, we did not. We did not sleep.
You saucy little minx. I know what you did.
Sleeping was not on the menu.
Brown chicken, brown cow.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that was dumb. I should have slept because now I'm all tired. And we don't put any humor into anything before we record.
No, we usually just, we just have facts. Like, we don't script anything.
And then we occasionally say something that's funny.
Like, crack a cold one open. Which Spencer, by the way, fucking loved. He texted me right after he heard it. He was like, crack a cold one open, that's fucking amazing. And I was like, really? Because it took me by surprise.
I know, you gave me that look and I was like, oh, did I go too far?
No, because your hand motions where you were like, cool, like you were breaking open a coconut. And I was like, oh, whoa. Holy shit.
Or like a wishbone.
Sorry. Did it again. You grab a leg, I'll grab a leg. We'll see who wins.
Oh, no.
But there's not really a whole lot of funny that we can make out of slavery and them being tortured and mutilated.
Especially in the way that they have been. Like, it's disgusting when we cover any case. But during this time...
Right.
Like, now if we hear somebody being tortured and mutilated and different things like that in other cases that we cover, now it's like a shock to us. It's terrible. Everybody can agree. But back then, it was just... Another day.
Yeah, no, because they would actually go on to say, so they had a lot of, like, unimaginable pain for these people, but was it real? Was it urban legend? Was it rumors? Did they take fucking things that looked awful and just spin them into fucking soccer mom orbit where it was like, oh, did you know that Susie?
Mm-hmm. Did they put some extra glitter on that?
Susie fucking didn't send her kids with non-GMO fucking organic strawberries to school. You know what I mean? And it just goes fucking rogue. So how true?
Take a little bit of truth, you add some embellishments.
Yeah, you fucking rub a little.
Look fancy, shiny. What are you rubbing? What are you doing?
I don't know what this hand motion is that I'm doing.
You look like you're tweaking a nipple. That's what you...
I'm jacking off a gnome. I don't know what I'm doing right now. If this were a Smurf, he'd be real happy. Because once again, that YouTube channel where I feel like maybe I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what to do with my hands.
You're looking at the palm of your hand like something's going to happen to it.
Okay. Ooh, all right. Okay. Back at the ranch.
Anyways.
We are not jerking off Smurfs.
We are not. No Smurf hand jobs.
Okay.
Today.
So, but did she really brutalize her slaves? Did she do all the things they say? Because who knows?
Mm-hmm. There was the old woman in the attic that had the head wound that was so bad that
she couldn't even fucking walk, mm-hmm. Ember. She couldn't fucking walk.
And they were all starved out. They had bones protruding from their bodies. We talked about their backs being fucking...
Where she fucking opened up their backs with the whips and everything. Like, dude, ooh.
But like a
you know what though?
Up...
Like, I get it. I like the revolt. I fucking get it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, if you're being treated worse than fucking cattle,
yeah.
I would be there too.
Maybe you don't treat people like shit and you wouldn't have people revolting.
Can't we all just fucking be homies and like get along and fucking hang out and eat popcorn and get real drunk or stoned and like just have some Lucky Charms fucking sticky treats and watch Rick and Morty? Like,
that just sounds wonderful.
I'm just saying, like, there's a method to my madness, but
like a fucked up Billy Mays commercial. But wait,
There's more! So, like we said, we can't really verify these accounts because they're so old, but there's a couple of different books if you guys want to check them out. There's Ghost Stories of New Orleans, Madame Delphine, Journey into the Darkness, which is called Journey into the Darkness, Ghosts and Vampires of New Orleans, and Retrospective Western Travel. And I believe that one's written in like the 30s.
Something like that.
38?
And then there was a newer one that was done in like 1998, but I can't remember which book was which.
But there's a lot of good books that you can read on.
And however, we'll kind of go into more of this story and how it goes into like pop culture and things like that. We'll get to that in a minute.
Meow. Which I... we'll get there. But moving on, here are some of the tortures that we told you that we would explain to you, which really super bother me because they're very sadistic. And it feels like she and maybe Louis had a very insatiable appetite because they would guess that not just the fucking 9 went in and only 2 died. They would say that they would actually take more slaves.
Yeah, like upwards of 100, I think.
And do fucked up shit. And then if they didn't live, they would either go and dump them or bury them on other properties.
Which there was...
What the fuck is under that cobble rock?
There was an account that when they redid the house later, that they had found a bunch of skeletons like under the floorboards.
Holy
they had
shit,
found bodies.
Kidding?
Yeah, they had found bodies and shit. And they had actually said that there was even like infants.
No.
And that some of them had been buried alive. They assume that one of the forms of punishment.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Was that a punishment? They take their babies and fucking kill them?
Bury them alive. Yeah, she was fucked up. When I read that, I was...
Are you serious?
Yeah. I have it down.
Where the fuck did you find that? Because I didn't
I'll
know
post
that.
It.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
That's deeply upsetting for me.
Yeah. When the house was sold, workers had uncovered under the house, under the floorboards, including infants, an indication proved that some of them had been buried alive. So that's nice. But then my question is, where did the infants come from?
Probably from...
Like, was Louis raping someone's slaves?
No, I don't think... Maybe.
And a baby came about, and
so
she
they
lost
fucking,
her mind, and
maybe.
She buried it?
Maybe, but there were also males and females on location that were employed... Finger quotes. Employed. It's not fucking employment.
They were kidnapped.
They were fucking kidnapped and held slave. That, you know, they bonded. They made relationships. They had kids, and some of their kids, you know, grew to be 12 years old before they threw themselves off the fucking roof to avoid being whipped. I mean, it's hard to say.
Yeah.
But it would be noted in several different pieces that the male slaves were chained to the wall. They were naked. They had their eyes gouged out. Their fingernails had been ripped out of the bed. Their joints had been skinned. So, like, knuckles, knees, ankles, that kind of thing. And they were festering with infection. And they had holes gouged into their buttocks where, like, large chunks of skin had actually been removed. And they had their ears dangling off their bodies. So was that from like a beating or were they being jerked around by their fucking ears?
Oof.
Hard to say, but I think it was probably more from like being, I think the chunks in their buttocks was probably from being caned and flailed.
Mm-hmm.
And their ears were probably hanging off their body because that's how they were being like jerked around while they were bound.
Mm.
So the two that died,
that
they found their skeletons. I believe this is what happened to them. However, I don't have
proof. Right.
But.
And some people will say yes, some people will say
no.
Bullshit.
It's fucking back and forth, dude.
It's he said, she said, then the truth in the middle somewhere.
Right. But their intestines had actually been pulled out of their tummies through wounds that had been created with kitchen utensils.
Mm-hmm.
And they would pull them out and wrap them around like belts and then leave these people to succumb to their injuries, which sometimes took days, weeks, who fucking knows? Ugh. With your guts fucking hanging out your belly. And they had their mouths sewn shut so that people couldn't listen to their fucking screams, or they would scream less, which to me seems like bullshit, because if I'm being tortured, I'm going to scream whether my mouth is fucking sewn shut or not, which a lot reminds me of that movie Strangeland, the Dee Snider movie where the girl screams in pain so hard she rips the stitches out of her mouth.
Yeah, but I mean, these people were also terrified, so...
Yeah, but how can you not fucking scream when you have that kind of shit happening to you? I can step on a fucking sharp rock and I squeak.
Right.
I'm a sissy-ass motherfucker.
You're a pretty princess. It's fine. I'm just kidding. Don't look at me like that, like you're gonna fucking...
I would never. I'm just gonna push you down while you're not looking and make it look like an accident. Wink.
Just so that's noted.
Now that everybody knows, I break my ankle, fucking Angel did it. I would never. I love you so much.
You can throw around premeditated
by that point. I would never hurt you. I love you so much.
I love you too.
Anyway, tell me about the...
Oh, so they also had large holes that were in their skulls that had been discovered on several slaves. Oh, Jesus, I can't talk.
Slaves.
That had been...
Several slaves have holes in their heads. You sound like fucking one of the generals from the fucking Confederate Army trying to, like, rally the fucking troops. Several slaves have holes in their heads.
Honestly.
All right, anyway, get it together.
Sorry, I can't read. That the holes had been from obvious, like, blunt force trauma. Blunt force trauma. Work. Then the sticks were placed in the holes. They found one that had the wooden spoon sticking out of the hole. Where are you going? She's having a moment. She's giggling.
I'm so sorry. I'm not laughing.
You can laugh. You're not laughing at the severity
of the case.
No, it's
just fucking our mouths. It's like turning on a fucking food processor. A food processor.
Okay.
A food processor. Sometimes
what happens in our brain is going too fast for our mouths to keep up, and so our tongue ends up doing this weird river dance.
It's fucking moonwalking in my mouth, and I can't make words.
And things are bad.
Whew, God.
But if this is your first time listening, you can go back through, and there's evidence of this in every single episode. I don't think it's ever
doorstop mouth, but we will probably do it forever.
Forever and ever.
Sorry, start again.
Okay, anyways, so blunt force trauma would happen to the slaves, cause holes. Sometimes they were found with like wooden spoons or things stuck.
Like open holes in their fucking skulls, and then they would put worms and things in their fucking owies and like put sticks in there, like torture them by poking their fucking wounds.
Stirring up their brain a little bit.
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
That is not spaghetti.
That's not okay.
Just not okay. So the one that I want to talk about, and I'll let you complete this. Because this is the one that totally fucking... So they took this one female slave, and there's not really an account that substantiates why she was in the room of no return, but they lopped off her arms, like a crude amputation, and then seared and like cauterized wounds. But then the doctor would later go in and take like a potato peeler and carve out her skin all around her body to make her look like a human caterpillar.
Good.
Uh-huh.
Good. That's gross.
Yeah.
But potato peelers?
A potato peeler, which we recently fucking talked about how awful those are for even us while we're doing normal everyday chores that we choose to do. But whether it was like a potato peeler or a crude knife, he would go in there and peel strips of flesh off of her body so that it gave her like the rings as though a caterpillar would have. And she had no arms. And then they would later take out her eyes.
That's nice.
Mm-hmm.
That's nice. Then you had the other female that they had said they broke her limbs.
They snapped them. No, they like fucking took them. You're giving the fucking live long and prosperous for those of you that know what the fuck Star Trek is. And they
with the Spocker.
Okay.
So sorry.
I know I needed that. So they would take her paws. I can't do it with this hand. And if you see me try, I just go, oh my God, I'm so jealous you can do it on both hands. I cannot. I can only do it on this one. My left hand. My right hand won't fucking, and it just goes, I can't. We're going to have to take a video of this.
Yeah.
Put it on the Facebook because I cannot. This one, fine. My brain will not manage this one.
Anyways, take your hands.
They would like split them and then bind them, like split them and then bind them.
When she's saying split them, she means if you take in between your middle finger and your ring finger and you cut that down into your palm.
Right.
Yeah.
They would then bind them and turn her into like a human crab with her digits.
Yeah. And they broke her bones all fucking weird and to like bound continue them. That. And so like, she now had little claws instead of
digits. No phalanges. They fucking, they would like take and rub like this on the skin with either a knife or something. And then when the skin starts to heal between the two,
like bind them together so it healed together.
Yep. And made like a little human crab.
This isn't far-fetched if you consider that her husband now
was a chiropractor.
So breaking and readjusting things in fun little positions may have been a fucking sick little hobby of his.
Potentially.
Oh, no.
So they reset her as the human crab, which... fuck you. And then we talked about the different flailings. So
I had also read that sometimes they would cover the slaves in like honey and then throw a bunch of black ants on them.
What the hell? Mm-hmm. Black ants or red ants?
I said black ants, but
I don't know, dude. There's some sketchy ass shit down in the South, and you'll never know the dangers of kicking over an anthill barefooted until you fucking do it. Yeah. Because what looks to be fucking harmless will leave these enormous, they look like pimples because the fucking toxin from when they bite you. Yeah, man. I learned the hard way. When I lived in Texas, fuck those things. They should all die.
Mm-hmm. And so this is the thing that people will say in this, that this was highly embellished, highly like...
oh, this is all fucking urban legend. It's all been made up.
You know? However, everybody that saw the slaves were completely repulsed. And when the judge put these slaves back up for auction...
well, they took them out and they actually put them on display at like a local, because like a jail or something, as kind of like a, like an attestment.
Like a
weird... like a testimony to her fucking
museum.
Yeah. Like to her atrocities or whatever. And
people came with the quickness.
Like 4,000 fucking people flocked to see this shit.
And to see how bad it really was.
Right.
And like we said, if you were this bad, considering not too many years before, but they were putting slaves' heads on spikes. Fucking poles.
But like what I'm really concerned about is like, you took these people and you put them on fucking display. You didn't like take them to get medical care, or did they? And we just don't know. I would hope that you would have the fucking human decency and the goddamn soul care of these fucking people before you, I don't know, put them on a carnival display.
You would think, but would they? Because then it's gonna take away from the actual severity of what actually happened to
them. So we just let them fucking sit there in pain and like let people fucking
keep those worms in their head. It's fine.
I fucking hate people.
This is
why I hate people, and I can't fucking do with people.
Mm-hmm.
People. All people.
All the peoples.
All people.
The more we research, the more we do things, the more I hate everyone.
No, the more I research, the more I research, the more I want to move further and further and further into the mountains. I don't think my brother
has a bad idea
about moving into
the middle of fucking... system.
He really does. The further into the mountains, I have to do more work, but I'm further away from people, so it kind of pans out.
Exactly.
Anyway. Because
this is all bullshit.
Bullshit. So then later, after they put all of these slaves that have been tortured and mutilated on display, they would actually go back to Jean Lalari and be like, dude, what the fuck is going on in your house? And he'd be like, mind your business. It's not a big deal. I realize it has a hole in his head, but it's not that severe. It'll live. What the fuck?
The French fried fuck is going on. Somebody explain.
Fuck. Fuck, what's wrong with you?
It was also noted from neighbors and different things like that, that the Lalari's marriage was not the best. They fought quite a bit. And it wasn't long after the fire and they actually found all the slaves, that he packed his bag, fucking took their daughter, and skied out. And trying to find information as like to what nobody, happened no,
the,
later.
This motherfucker ghosted out like the FBI, you know, what is it called? Witness protection.
Mm-hmm.
Motherfucker disappeared with a child and was never to be seen again.
And most of the neighbors had said, wasn't that big of a... it wasn't a shock for him to leave. But then it kind of shifted all the blame
to
directly
her.
On her, which is why she's known...
the fucking monster of New Orleans.
Which she still is a monster and a piece of shit,
but what
no
is it? What was it, him or was it her? Because really, We don't know.
Either way.
Was she a fucking sicko? Was he a fucking sicko?
Were they sickos too...
to fucking gather? It was like some natural born killers. They like found their fucking monster soulmate and they were like, let's peel the skin off this thing and see how long it lives.
Yeah. Let's turn a human into a caterpillar.
Do you want to stretch this thing?
It will
thing
turn
from
into
its...
a beautiful butterfly.
Oh my God. Do you want to stretch this thing from its neck and see how long it lives? What the fuck is wrong with you?
Yeah, because there's no way either of them were innocent.
No, not at all. If one were doing it without the other's consent, you would still have to fucking know.
Oh, yeah.
And like, my husband can't take a shit without me walking in on him. How the fuck are you going to peel skin, break limbs, and stretch people from their fucking necks and nobody know?
And have slaves just be up in a room and never return. Yeah, it's just... But what happens is when the people come and they see...
No, they broke in. They were like, they heard stories. They broke in. Like, the locals came.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
well,
what the fuck?
Well, yeah. What, after they saw the ones that were put on fucking weird ass display, it pissed a lot of people off.
Which I'm thankful for.
They knew.
Dang you.
They knew. Thank you so much. We were writing letters earlier today, and I wrote out thank you.
I farted. I laughed so hard I farted. You know what? Fuck it. I don't even care. It is what it is. I laughed hard. I farted.
You want me to?
You know, I don't even care. Keep it.
You're like, it's fine.
It's life.
I
you know
love
what?
How you told on yourself.
I don't even care. You know what? People fart. I apologize. We were writing out thank you
letters
with our stickers and Spencer hat.
Ember.
I fucking cannot.
Okay, Angel needs a minute.
Ember had a moment where she was writing out a thank you, and instead of putting thank you, she put fang you.
Thang you. Fang like, you, and I kept it. I was like
whatever, it's going.
It's fine. So whoever gets that, you're welcome.
Yeah. Which is why I'm laughing right now, and I laughed so hard I farted, and I don't know how Spencer got brought into this. I apologize for nothing.
Anyways, a riot breaks out.
Yes, and they actually decide to, and this is the thing, thank you for all the people that at least decided to fucking
stand up
and be like, fuck you, you're a monster, get the fuck out, because she fled overnight. She took a carriage, they took her to Mobile, Alabama, she hopped a fucking ship and off to France she went. But in the meantime,
before they went in and they knew where to hit her, where it fucking count
hurted the most,
where it hurted good,
because they fucking destroyed all of her precious belongings.
They fucked that house
they
up.
They essentially tore it down from the studs. They took the pictures. They took the wallpaper. They took the fucking furniture, the curtains, the lovely things she had in her home.
They took knives to, like, the feather bed, so there's fucking feathers.
They fucking gutted everything. Like, everything that she thought was important and better than taking care of people, they fucking destroyed it. So
if you get people in the 1800s who were putting slaves' heads on poles as, like, a no big thing, if you get those people pissed off enough to where they're destroying your fucking home and they're calling you a monster,
right? Dude, you are a shit heel of a human being. So
she's like the afterbirth of the devil. Anyways, so that's when she fled,
and there's not a whole lot to go off of after she bails.
No,
that's the fucked up thing, is like
there's rumors
that, well, there are, because they would actually say that there was a plate that was found that, like, a French Sexton. You can't fucking say things like that and have me take you serious. But
his name is Eugene Bex, by the way.
Eugene Bex. He would actually find a plate that had her birthday and her death date and her full fucking all of her names after being fucking widowed twice and remarrying, but that showed that she had actually died. And
he didn't find that until 1924. And on the dates, it said that she had died December 7th of 1849. So we're talking almost...
Right.
Almost. Not quite 100 years, but 80-something years later?
Yeah.
Is when that was found.
So, but there would be people that said that after she fled her country to get away from being convicted from her crimes, that she would take that carriage to Mobile, she'd hop on a fucking ship, and she'd bail the fuck out. But that she died in 1888 by a boar hunting accident.
She doesn't seem like the type that would go hunting boars.
I could hunt a boar. You could hunt a boar.
prissy bitch that was worrying about throw pillows.
Fucking bacon. But a bitch that was worried about the fucking wallpaper in her house, so she hung up hides that wouldn't, you know,
destroy it?
Let the blood soak through.
I doubt it. Another one.
So maybe that was something that was said to, like, throw people off the trail. Like, oh, she died in 1888 because Big Pig got her.
Well, and another rumor that had happened was that she actually came back to New Orleans and she was under a different name.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Okay.
Because it goes into some of the...
hit me because I just got real slighted.
It comes into part of the pulp culture. Jesus. OJ, extra pulp. I'm so... pulp culture.
I fucking hate pulp. Unless it's fiction. And then we can watch that.
I need somebody to take an orange juice bottle and put...
Oh my God, dude.
Pulp culture on it for me.
All right.
Anyways, that she had came back to New Orleans under a different name. I can't talk. I don't know why the fuck
you're
asking me.
It's me and you both. No, it's me and you both. Like, we keep feeding off each other's fucking
derps. Let me go to my other part of the notes where it kind of talks about it. Because there's a bunch of different, like, stories,
like different accounts,
things that come later that people had built, because one of the rumors is that she came back, she worked in a different plantation in Louisiana and continued the same.
Where though? Did it say the area?
I don't think so, but I could probably find it. It's in one of these books that she had come back to a different plantation. That plantation is also haunted, supposedly.
So they would also talk about the property at 1140 Royal Street as being haunted. And if you walk by there at certain times of night, you can actually hear, like, screams and cries coming from the property. Now, me being a person that lived in New Orleans for quite some time, I lived off right off Bourbon Street. I actually lived in the Ramada Inn, which is kitty corner from the fucking Funky Pirate. Mm-hmm. Yes, I did live in a hotel for a short period before I got an apartment further down the way, almost by Redfish, but which is now closed. And that makes me very sad because they had excellent fucking food. I never heard a goddamn thing. And I have circled that property multiple times. I've looked in there, which, by the way, it is a beautiful fucking property.
Property.
The property.
Property.
That's pretty. Tell me about them rabbits, George. But it is a beautiful property. And it was so beautiful that Nicolas Cage actually purchased it in
2007.
And I think it went up for foreclosure in 2009 while he was having some rough go with paying his taxes.
Well, yeah. And his career kind of tanked.
But they
blamed it on the curse. So I forget exactly where we were at. We had to pause. Help.
Children. It happens. So, but Nicolas Cage would actually purchase that property in, like, 2007. And it would go up for foreclosure due to, like, some tax issues.
Yeah.
But it would be turned into many, many things over the years prior to being the fucking vacation home of a celebrity.
Yes. Because Nicolas Cage had bought that because he wanted to write, like, a book. Some sort of book, I remember. And he thought that this haunted mansion.
This place was going to give him some kind of fucking inspiration.
Nicolas Cage is a little bit of a fucking weirdo, though.
Dude, have you seen his fucking kid?
Did you like that meme that I sent to you? I'm going to post it online where it says Nicolas Cage can play any role, and it's a girl who looks like a
stamp. She's not a bad looking girl, but when you put it that way, you're like,
I laughed.
No, you have
violently
to look up his son.
Yes. Well, because he was fucking weird. There was other.
It is weird. I think most
talking
actors
about
are fucking weird.
After his dad died, he took his ashes to, like, this lake type of thing where he wanted his
Would he, like, rail him out on a fucking mirror and snort them for breakfast?
That's where I thought the story was going. He might have. But it was something, like, he would talk
Did
about
Did you hear that story once? About how some intruders broke into somebody's home and they had recently put their grandmother's ashes into a glass urn and they were, like, mostly white. Mm-hmm. And these people broke into this home and they thought that it was, like, a prominent family that had, like, an urn full of fucking coke. And they stayed up all night snorting grandma's ashes. It wasn't cocaine.
It just reminds me of the...
I gotta find that fucking story.
You do. It reminds me of the Cards Against Humanity card that says snorting your father's ashes.
There's something wrong with us.
I didn't make the card. It was just there.
I don't know, but some of them that you've made have been worse than the fucking originals.
I know.
So, but anyway.
Anyways.
This building would actually, you can stand on the roof and see the Mississippi. You can stand over it and look over all of the French Quarter. And I think that was kind of why it was turned into so many things, is because it was a prime location, because it went from like private school to music conservatory to a home for wayward youth, a bar, a furniture store, luxury apartments. Then it was Nicolas Cage's fucking writing grotto.
He could sit and be a fucking weirdo.
While it was a private school.
Yes. It's well known that this is known as like the haunted house.
Yes, right.
Type of thing. Right. So some of the stories that came from it is back when it was a private school, that girls, and mostly, if I remember right, I would have to go back through and double check, but when it was one of the private schools, it was predominantly for African American girls later in life.
Interesting. What a fucked up place
to do that. Right. Why would you put...
Well, maybe they didn't know the history, but I find that hard to believe.
Yeah. I don't think the children didn't know the history, but...
How could you fucking not, living in New Orleans, though?
Right. You know, they would say that they don't think that they necessarily knew, because these kids were only like 7. Okay.
So they wouldn't learn until later.
Yeah.
But
they would show up to the teacher. They would like go to the bathroom or something like that and come back. Scratches on their arms. Yeah. And bruises.
Like visible fucking owies.
Mm-hmm. And whenever a teacher would ask, and this would happen in multiple different classrooms at multiple different times, it wasn't like a group of girls would come back and say this.
Like single little babins.
Yeah, one at a
time. Going somewhere, and they come back and be like, look.
Yeah, and whenever a teacher would ask what happened, they would always say the lady did it, and that was it. And so what stemmed off of that is that she... Yeah,
I got the chills. Yeah, sorry.
Is that she still haunts that area. And because of...
How the fuck did she get all the way back there? Unless she really did come back all the way to the French Quarter, fucking died somewhere else, and somebody like dumped her bullshit at that location. Because like I said, I've been there. I've been there multiple times. I lived in New Orleans for quite some time.
Mm-hmm. But they say basically from the time that it was restored until even now, is people don't usually live there for longer than 5-year increments. And there's a rich oil-filled guy that owns it currently that bought the property, and he bought it in 2012-2013.
It was like $3.5 million. Yeah. It's expensive as fuck to live out there. Mm-hmm. Like, especially if you're going to live in the quarter, the rent for my place, the apartment that I had on Bourbon, mm-hmm. was over $2,200 a month. Ew. Rent.
Nope.
Which was why I turned two of the bedrooms into an Airbnb, because I was a poor motherfucker. Okay, I take that back. I was a bartender.
It was not that bad. But so that's kind of what we have now. And now we can kind of move more into that pulp culture.
The pulp.
Urban legend.
Urban legend.
Urban legend.
In the pulp culture.
And so as many people know, Kathy Bates played
American Horror Story.
Yep.
She played Madame Lalaurie.
Yes. So
she's played many amazing roles.
I love Kathy Bates.
Dude,
so
what's your favorite one?
Misery.
Mine would be Fried Green Tomatoes. Tawanda! I don't know which one I love more.
Mm. I haven't watched Fried Green Tomatoes because I heard it was going to make me cry, so I never
it probably will.
It.
The mousy fucking housewife that finds her independence, or the one that breaks ankles and fucking holds people captives? I don't know. But she has done a lot of American Horror Story and has done an amazing job.
Yes.
She really is like a fucking feather of many colors.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And then like we talked about earlier, they say, you know, like on a cold night, once everything, you know, dies down, and sometimes you can catch it on the wind, the screams of the slaves
like
being
the
tortured
souls.
Which I think that just comes with any time a house is said to be haunted, there's always going to be those kind of
stories. I think that might be urban legend, or maybe somebody's a little more tuned into things than I am. But
well, and I feel like if you're looking for something,
you're gonna
like
find
if you
it.
Put that in your head yeah. that you might be able to hear screams.
Oh shit, dude,
you're gonna hear.
Go wander around those fucking graveyards, like mm-hmm. those mausoleums and shit.
Well, I know my mind plays fucking tricks on me all the time. I'll worry, and what if somebody's in my house, and then I'll be trying to go to sleep, and I'll hear something. I'll be like, that's a footstep. And it wasn't.
Says the bitch that didn't even know her husband was standing in the fucking hall staring at her.
I know. That's still
Doesn't
makes
that freak
me
you the fuck out.
Yeah.
Your dog should make more noise.
My dog is...
You should get a Chihuahua. They make noise at everything. You'll never sleep again, and you'll never know if it's true or not, but at least they'll make noise.
Right, and maybe that will wake up the pit bull, and maybe he might do something. He's decoration. He's wonderful, but he's just...
You know what? My Akita actually showed for the first time ever
some
guard dog tendencies where somebody tried to allegedly reach through the truck window and pet him.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think somebody was trying to take him out of the truck.
I think somebody was probably trying to steal shit in your truck.
I think he was probably trying to take the truck because the truck was running.
Yeah.
And not that I have the best truck in the world, but if a truck is running, a truck is running.
Well.
But what they did get was bit the fuck up.
Yep. That's what happens when you're a dumbass. Also,
rough go.
There was a historically themed wax museum in the French Quarter that actually had like a scene that depicted the slave room of no return.
Which I think is now closed.
Yes, it has been closed.
The wax museum is now gone.
It's like, Musée Conte Wax Museum. I can't say it. So I'm just going to say it fast and in a weird accent.
Fucking, you got the angry fucking,
no, it's a wax museum. The wax museum.
God, we're home.
Also later in a paper, this is much later, in 1934, a person named Megs Frost said that all of the torture that happened was just basically a smear campaign brought on by that neighbor whose name was this.
Monsieur Montreal?
That fucker.
And borka borka bork.
Yes. That it was just a smear campaign, but they were kind of going off of Madame Lalaurie's friends and other people that were like, no, but she was a nice lady. She gave the slave half a glass of wine. Like, that's...
But there were other people that were like, yeah, but no, there's something wrong with her. Now, was that at the behest of the Monsieur, or those actual accounts of people being like, no, she's fucked up?
Well, if you take slaves and put them on parade for 4,000 people to see how bad they were treated, I'm pretty sure you're a piece of shit.
No, something's wrong. You did some nasty things and you should probably be burned with fucking hot pokers.
Mm-hmm. So some of the other things...
I said that out loud.
It's okay. Whatever. It didn't even faze me. I was like, yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah, so anyways.
Sometimes I say things. I say them out loud.
But some of the other stuff was, there was the Lalaurie Horror, which was a poem that kind of put into chronological order of things that happened in the mansion, like the history of it, mm-hmm. and some of the folklore that came from
it. Like, with it, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it was written by Jennifer Reeser. And that's not me fucking up. It's Reeser.
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 Terser.
Terser. Terser in the river.
River. So Jennifer Reeser.
Yes, wrote that poem that goes through the mansion's history and all the folklore that's happened in the past hundreds of years. And in 2000, a man by Ted... Nicolau. See, I'm terrible at names.
It's okay.
People should just have basic fucking easy
Smith,
things.
Jones, Hammond, Mays.
Fucking don't confuse the ginger.
If you freak it out, it'll collect your soul and then it gets a new freckle.
Yeah. He had made a movie. Let's see. Yes. Okay. So this was the movie that I was trying to talk about earlier. It's called St. Francisville Experiment. And it was an experiment. It's probably like a really bad B-rate movie is my guess.
Dude, I liked the shit out of Zombievers. So I'll probably love this.
I know. We're
Did you like
B-rate.
That movie?
Yes.
Oh my God. It was fucking amazing.
It wasn't as funny as like Poltergeist for me.
Poltergeist and fucking Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving.
Oh my God.
The gravy flavored condom is still to this day. Anyways, it's...
Do you dry hump better than all the boys on the basketball team? Dude, B-rate...
You've just been stuffed, bitch.
Dude, the B-rate movies are the best.
It was. Okay, so it was about a camera crew ghost hunting of thing. They visit different plantation houses. And in one of them...
I would not want to do that.
In one of them, in this movie, they supposedly find physical and spiritual evidence. I'm finger quoting the fuck out of all of
this. Yeah, dude, you're like...
They're dancing.
Little bunny foo-foo hopping through the forest.
Little bunny foo-foo in this.
Man, we're going to have to take a video. Little bunny foo-foo hopping through the forest, scooping between, up the field mice, bopping them on the head.
Between little bunny foo-foo, you jerking off a Smurf, and you trying to do the Spocker. It's been a great day.
We finally found our humor.
And maybe it's just for us because we're the only ones that can see it.
I know. Fine. God. All right. Okay, we got to do a video. First we jerk off Smurfs. Then we do a Spocker.
They find evidence that she had fled to this specific house after the fire comes to this different plantation house to continue her torture. Apparently in this video, in this movie.
Interesting.
They find evidence, which I don't know what that necessarily would be. They have tour guides all the time.
All the fucking time, all over the fucking quarter.
And all the tour guides have had their own personal paranormal experiences.
Of course they fucking have.
Tugging on the bag, seeing her standing in the hallway. There was one account that on the street, like the street light, like an old, they still had like an old candle-ish street light, apparently. Mm-hmm. And they would say Leah and the street light would turn on. And then if they said it again, it would blow out. Now, could that have been rigged up for some way to sell
some
more tickets?
Some tourist fucking trap, probably.
Yeah, that's probably
my guess. I'm pretty leery of a lot of things, but you know that I'm a little bit more sensitive. So, I'm not a psychic. I fucking hear things. I see things. Like,
you're just more open.
And that was after that fucking car accident that I got into that bunked my fucking head. So maybe I'm just delusional. I don't fucking
maybe
know.
Maybe you're on your way to a serial killer. Most serial killers also bonk their head. Should I be worried?
I don't know. Should you?
I don't know. Just don't kill me and let me know first because the podcast still has to go on.
If you're going to go fucking rogue, I need to find a new co-host. So could you not?
Or we're going to have to set like once a week visits.
It might be through a phone and some plexiglass, but we're going to do it.
Back to more of the whole folklore, urban legend, fucking whatever.
No, hit me, dude. I like it.
In 2004, James Merendino directed a movie called Trespassing, a.k.a. Evil Remains. And it's a story about a grad student studying in folklore.
Okay.
He's doing research, and so he goes on an expedition to plantation houses in New Orleans. And
I think you're fucking tiptoeing through some pretty dangerous fucking territory doing that.
Mm-hmm. And the specific home that he goes to in this book, the backstory of the lady that owned it is almost directly pulled from Madame Lalaurie's story.
Interesting.
So that movie is based on this.
Gotcha.
In 2015, there was a book written by Martin Cage called Demoness.
Martin Cage?
Yes. Did I say him? What did I say?
No, you said Martin Cage, okay. But considering that Nicolas Cage owned the home, I wonder if there's a ding, relation. Ding, ding, ding,
ding. Spelled different.
Okay, maybe not.
Maybe. Who knows?
I was just speculating.
And in this book, Madame Lalaurie was actually she's reincarnated from the demon Lilith.
Oh, God.
Yeah. So Lilith's reincarnation.
The fucking blood god.
Yeah. Was Madame Lalaurie. Mm-hmm. And that's what that book is about. So I'm like,
I kind of want to listen to that.
I want to
check that out. And when I say listen.
Yeah.
I'm talking about our audible.com thing. Because you guys can actually go get a 30-day free trial with one free download.
Mm-hmm.
At audibletrial.com/colormedead.
Yes.
And if you decide to keep that membership, it's $15 a month for one download. And I previously gave incorrect information on the three download thing, which is actually 35. I apologize. I'm a bad person.
It's okay. It's fine.
Happens. But if you guys are interested in that, and I highly recommend you get on that, because if you're a busy motherfucker on the go.
And give us book information. Like,
yeah, dude, find us some new stuff to listen to.
Book club. Let's all read books
Oh
together.
My God. Bridge and books.
Let's listen to books and talk about it.
So, but you can do that and get that free free membership for 30 days. Check it out.
I really do like Audible. It's,
I love Audible.
It makes researching so much easier.
It really does.
It really does. Anyways, some more of her different places where Madame Lalaurie has popped up within our pulp culture.
Pulp culture.
I'm just fucking driving that home.
Oh line. My God. Just go ahead and push your glasses up one more time, though.
Got it. she's actually a character in a board game called Evil Baby Orphanage. Never heard of it.
What the fuck? We gotta find that.
Mm-hmm. Google that shit. And apparently she also appears in a PC game called Dead Time Stories. And there's also, she appears in the second part of Barbara Hambly's Benjamin January Mysteries. And it's called Fever Season, is the Madame Lalaurie story. Pops up in there. The story of the mansion is told in issues 13 through 18 of Serena Valentino's Nightmares and Fairy Tales. So you can find that there. There's also another story from John Dickon Cars. His miss...
Dick in Cars.
Dixon Cars. Dicks in Cars. Yep. Got Dicks... John's Dicks in the Car. So John's Dick in the Car, his mystery story called Papa Labasse, published in 1968, cast doubts on the truth of the torture and slaves by Madame Lalaurie. So in that one, he tries to say that she didn't do anything.
Okay, but wait, I'm sorry. So I did what you told me to do.
Uh-huh.
And did you Google that? I Googled the game.
Uh-huh.
I want you to hear the description.
Let's all hear it together. Let's find out.
A semi-educational game.
Oh.
Of time travel and abduction.
Oh, can we get that?
I will order it today.
And we need that game.
Because 3 to 6 players, it takes 15 minutes to play, and ages 13 and up, semi-educational of time travel and abduction? What the actual fuck? Wait, the game consists of 2 decks, the baby deck and the nanny deck.
Oh no, baby deck, that sounds terrible. Semi-educational.
And abduction. So, but then, during your turn as the nanny cards, you have to adopt babies from your friends and keep them in check, or the babies go nuts.
If I'm fucking lying,
I'm dying. Read that shit.
Oh my God.
So this fucking game that's called Evil Baby Orphanage, which I don't know if it's the right fucking thing, but it's the first thing that popped up.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
And you have to see the fucking picture of the game. It looks like a scene out of Ed and Eddie from fucking...
Right? Then each of your babies takes its unsupervised actions unless you can calm them down with toys or nap time. Finally, adopt an evil baby from the time stream, 3 face-up babies from the baby deck. Draw more nannies and end your turn. Start your turn with 10 mischief and win the game. But be careful. Containing the world's most mischievous babies isn't easy. Keep your babies from burning down your orphanage as you try to keep the Unabomber away from the arts and crafts table, Kim Jong away from the toy rocket ship.
Oh my God. Yep, we're buying it.
Happening.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but...
No, you're fine, because I'm on my very last one. The last one is a musician, and Glaswegian? It's a Glaswegian musician. His real name is Andrew Bell, but his, like, stage name or presence name is Delphine Lalaurie.
Interesting.
Yeah, so that's that. That's where we're gonna end the case of a terrible, terrible slave owner who ripped out fingernails and tortured people and put fucking wooden dowels in their fucking heads and...
You know, turned them into crabs and caterpillars and, you know, threw little girls off buildings.
Mm-hmm. Skin knuckles down to the bone. Even if I... Let me be a total fucking piece of shit for 2 seconds.
You're right. You got... I'll give you 2 minutes. Go.
All right. Even if we're gonna go from the time of slavery and different things like that, what would be the point of abusing a slave to where it's basically useless? You have a useless thing.
I think if it was... Okay, so my response, also being a total piece of shit, if you're that kind of a person, I think until it's dead.
Mm-hmm. But because wouldn't that seem like a waste of money?
I don't know.
That's like buying a brand new dishwasher and then blowing it up. Why? I told you I was going piece of shit.
But if you are a real piece of shit and that was your main intent to fuck them up until they died,
yeah.
Really, until they died, they served a fucking purpose. Whether it was to feed feed your sick, twisted fucking needs or whatever.
And back then there was a lot of sick, fucking twisted needs. And unfortunately, since owning slaves was an okay thing, it gave people fucking
an outlet to do that
field
shit
of fuckery without anybody being like, hey, you probably shouldn't do that.
You know?
It's and probably not a good thing.
It's... Oh, one of them fucking took a dip. Wait, wait, wait. That's like three of them.
Uh-huh. Child down.
Look, shh, listen. Your sister keeps going, shh. She's trying to shush them for the podcast. She's trying so hard. Thanks, Hannah.
She's A plus.
No, she's trying really hard. Thank you, Hannah.
Yes, we greatly appreciate it.
So, but thank you guys so much for listening because...
Yeah, sorry this one was heavy.
Yeah, no, it just... we can usually find humor in everything. Mm-hmm. And I think we found a little, but when you talk about slavery and dismembering and throwing little girls off roofs.
Well, really,
not
really.
A roof.
Well, really, roofs. Throwing them off.
Roofs.
Well, and it doesn't help.
Sounds like fucking drug you might pick up at a concert. You want a roof?
You want a roof?
You want to go off roofies?
It sounds like a basic white bitch trying to say roofies. Let's get some roofies. Kill it. Sorry.
But if it's 70 degrees and you're wearing Uggs, I will fucking kick you into the gutter.
And it has a pumpkin spice latte from fucking
And it's
Starbucks.
Wearing fucking shorts.
Kill it. I'm just kidding. Don't kill it. I'm not condoning violence.
Oh my God. Do as we say, not as we do. She didn't say that out loud. She thought it.
I'm sure we have some wonderful listeners that also enjoy pumpkin spice lattes from Starbucks.
I am that cunt that, like, when pumpkin spice things come out, I enjoy them for that period.
Ew.
Yep.
I was a barista for way too long. I hate pumpkin spice shit.
That's fine. You can judge me from over
because
here. I don't care.
I'm
bigger than you. I'll pick you up and throw you.
It starts in like August and it doesn't fucking end.
And it doesn't end.
I'm like,
you know what? No,
it does
like,
not belong in everything. Okay.
No, there are some things where I'm like, you've crossed a fucking line. But like the pumpkin. Oh, dude, the creme brulee. Lattes when they do those like around Christmas and shit. But I do like the pumpkin spice creamer for my coffee and whatnot.
Your husband enjoys the fuck out of eggnog lattes.
God, I fucking know. God, and it's gross. You're a bad person, you bitch. No, dude, eggnog's fucking nasty. It's like snot with a sweet flavor. It's foul.
It's just a cup full of cum. It's fine.
I cannot wait for Spencer to listen to this fucking gay boy. I almost said the F word. The other F word.
The other one.
The other one. Which, you know, I'm allowed to say it to certain people, but I'm not going to say it on air.
Right. Right. But yeah, it's basically the same consistency. So, here's...
Bank your homo mouth. Cum guzzler.
I bet if he could reach, he probably would swallow his own. It's fine.
He wouldn't need me then. And we have talked about that. Which is why I don't let him go to yoga.
Yeah, well, Spencer's too big. He would never be able to, like, contort his fucking spine that much.
I don't know. Some people have. I've seen it on the dark webs.
Yeah, but
ooh!
They're not.
Give me a pen. That website I want to show you.
Oh, yes.
Which I'm not going to say out loud, but let's do some shout outs.
Yes. Who do we want to shout out this week? Let me look. We've had so many awesome people, especially on our Twitter.
My God, we've really made a lot of friends, which is, it really is lovely.
Oh, we're supposed to do for our friend on the Braless podcast for uterus roast.
Oh my God. Yes, please.
Yes. We're supposed to do a little recording of a uterus roast to send to her. So that should be fun. Who else? Did we ever talk about Red Handed? Because I really do like that podcast.
You did Black Handed.
Yeah, Black Hands. Oh, by the way, was not in Australia. I was so tired when we recorded it and I said Australia. And it's wrong. It was New Zealand. So deepest apologies for fucking that up because some of our friends.
Two totally fucking different places.
Yeah, some of our friends were like, no, we're home of a lot of things, but fuck those guys. I was like,
oh,
not New Zealand, but the Black Hands murder case. Like, she's like, fuck that piece of shit.
I think we should make the Bralesque podcast, we should send her a fucking cake of her uterus being cut in half that says bon voyage.
Yes.
Fuck your uterus. Make it go away.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry that she has to get it removed.
I know.
That's never fun. It's trying to murder her. So she's like, fuck you. You're getting evacuated.
Go away.
Stranger Than podcast.
Yes.
They give us lots of love. Love them so much.
Don't hate. Ovulate. And if it doesn't, then we kills it, precious. So, yes. And Films X-Rayed?
Yes. Yes.
Check that out.
They do, exactly what they say. Films, and they fucking break it down. Stranger Than is, you know, paranormal, urban legends, different things like that. Which I think would be fun if we
did like a crossover with like maybe, or staring at each other. So we let you guys pick listener's choice. And the clear choice was Skinwalker Ranch. However,
I think we're going to save that and maybe try to do a crossover.
Yeah, and here's why, guys. It's not that we don't want to do the episode. It's that that's not really true crime.
And there's which not is much our true MO. Crime we could find.
No. I mean, there's a lot of books and there's a lot of personal accounts, but it's not necessarily true crime. It's like UFOs. It's fucking urban legend. So I think we might do that like episode.
We would love to do a crossover with any sort of urban legend type podcast
because
so if you listen we, and you do that
we live here I've been there I've been there multiple times I will never go back I'll leave it at that
so I think that would be fun to do a crossover episode so I think I'm gonna break it down to polygamy or the stupid reasons people do crime
let's talk about being August 23rd the Robin Slim fucking Color Me Dead crossover real quick
oh yeah we're gonna be on the Robin Slim show
oh shit I didn't realize you were fucking going
Oh,
sorry. So August 23rd, you guys, we're actually
going to
be...
We can cut it out. We'll ask Rob if it's okay. If he says no, then we'll cut it out. It's fine.
Fuck Rob.
Anyways.
So, but that could be misconstrued in a lot of different ways. Like, fuck him in a not sexual way.
No.
So, but no, we're going to be on the August 23rd. Okay, I don't think that's when the episode drops. I think that's when we're recording, but we're going to be a guest on the Robin Slim Show, which I highly recommend you check out. I'm very, very excited because I love the shit out of Rob because he says fuck more than I do. And he's got a quirky little accent that I think if I had somebody narrate my whole day.
Yeah.
I would have Rob do it.
He has a great little accent.
A little accent.
Oh, also, your wonderful singing on our last episode.
Oh, shit. My Color Me Dead.
The two.
Come inside, take off your clothes, I'll make you feel at home. Now let's pour a glass of wine, because now we're all alone. Sorry.
The two Bobs.
I know, they decided to take that.
And they're going to put it on their show. So.
I was really into Color Me Dead. Whatever. I'm so glad you're my girl. I'll do anything for you. Call you every night and give you flowers too.
I'm gonna need you to stop.
Just, I can. The whole fucking, probably the whole album, but whatever.
Simmer it down.
Listen, take your bum hoodie off.
Oh my god.
Give me enough bum.
So the bum hoodies were like the Arrow hoodies now or
oh my
back
god.
In
like Arrow or fucking yeah dude there was Gimme Enough and Bum.
Yep.
And I wore all of it.
And if you had them you were kind of cool.
I stole mine from a local clothing store because I was a fucking bum teenager.
It's fine now because it's so
the clothing
now.
Store is closed. I don't give a fuck. I was a shoplifting little fool until my mom caught me and beat the hell out of me. Mm. That was the one time. Remember how I talked about like there was only a handful of times I got my ass kicked?
Yeah, that was one of them.
She fucked me up. And then she took my light bulb out of my room and I had to go to bed at 9 o'clock or not 9 o'clock. I had to go to bed when she took the light bulb out at like 7 o'clock every night.
Nice.
And she took my stereo and everything out of my room. So like she even took the fucking door off the hinges.
Well, don't be a fucking cunt teenager.
Me right. Because I do the same thing to my kids. Without hitting them, I take their shit.
Right.
Fuck you. You want to act like a gangster? I'll put you in prison. Good night. 6:30. Like the lights are, like it's still sunlight outside. And they're like, but it's the sky's awake. Fuck you. You go to bed. Take your light.
Oh, I was also supposed to ask, whatever came out of the clapper experiment, did that ever happen?
Oh, Jesus Christ. That has to be a Quinn thing. Who asked?
I don't remember. I'm going to have to go back through and look. But somebody listened to our episode 9, our Nance shit show, when we're talking about if you jerk off hard enough, will the lights flicker? So that should be Spencer has some homework still.
Should we call him really quick?
We like Spencer.
Yeah, no, I think we should just call him really quick. Hold on.
Okay.
And we'll put it on speakerphone. And the audio might be really bad on this, you guys.
Hello.
Hi, baby.
Hello, bud. What are you doing?
Well,
you're actually being recorded.
You're being recorded right now. And somebody contacted us and wanted to know what happened with the clapper experiment, because you were supposed to take time off work and jerk off to the clapper to see if it makes a strobe light.
Well, I guess I will have to do that. You're going to need to stay away from the house for about a half hour.
All right. So what you're telling me is I need to have a beverage and go smoke, and you're going to go up into our son's room and jerk off.
No, I will be taking the clapper room. Thank you.
Okay, well, our listeners are deeply concerned about your commitment to this show, so I'm going to need you to go do that
and report back.
Fair enough.
The good lotion's on the counter. I'll see you in a little bit.
Okay.
I love you.
Love you too.
Bye.
That's so great. Oh, shit. All right.
You know he's going to fucking push me when he gets home. He's going to be like, what the hell is wrong with you? And I don't mean that in a way.
No,
never. It's like a one finger shoulder poke.
Oh, I did it.
Come inside, no, take off your clothes, I'll make you feel at home. Dude, I'll start serenading you.
No, please don't.
All right. So, but then stay off Royale Street and get out of attics.
Yeah.
And stay out of chalk lines.
Yeah. Fuck stupid, pretty women. Not literally. Don't fuck them. Like, if they seem pretty and they care too much about throw pillows, they'll probably beat you. Don't hang out with them because she's
or
evil.
Cut your fucking skin off your joints.
Make you look like a caterpillar. A caterpillar. Or a crab.
Oh my god. Pink a pink. Stay out of chalk lines and don't look like a crab.
Did she pinch you?
Oh my god.
Did she put her claws all over your body?
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Ashes.